In this video, I will introduce to you, or at least attempt to introduce to you, the origin story of quantum mechanics. Let me begin by saying welcome to the 20th century, because unless if you've done special relativity, this is probably your first view of physics discovery that are done in the 20th century. Now, this is an origin story. It is a story, so we won't be super rigorous and technical about everything, but I want to show you that quantum mechanics is not something a bunch of physicists sat around in a room and somehow got really wild imagination and just made this thing together to torment students for all eternity. What this is a story of really interesting and weird observations, fairly hard intellectual struggle, some kind of ad hoc explanation, ultimately leading to a more coherent framework as we know as quantum mechanics. I will begin by conceding to the great Richard Feynman. He said that the rules are so screwed that you're not going to believe them. I'll refer you to the actual video where I got this from. You can follow this link here. He does a very good job setting you up for how to view this quantum theory as a whole and approach it on the outset. I suggest doing 20 to 35 minutes, but he's quite captivating, so I won't blame you if you go all the way, but it is an hour long. And I'll let you do that now. So I hope that was fairly entertaining and insightful for you guys. Our story back here now begins in the 1880s. This was probably the days of perhaps your grandfather's grandfathers, or your grandmother's grandmother, of course. And surprisingly, you know, it doesn't seem so far back, but the world was a very different place back then. There were no widespread automobile. The first manufactured automobile was in 1886 by Benz. Telephones were just invented, so there's telegraphs, but not telephones. Widespread electrical generation started coming in 1882, and people didn't think you could fly in any controlled manner until 1903. So obviously it's a very different world. So not only do everyday life look very different because there's none of these everyday necessities that we think of nowadays, but the idea of the electron and the nucleus hasn't been discovered yet. Can you imagine the world where people don't know about electrons and nucleus? In any case, that's going to all change in the next 50 years. We have from 1880s to 1930s. In this next 50 years, a lot of exciting happened in the world of physics, and it completely changed the face of it. So first, the coming about of quantum mechanics is the interplay between the electron and light, or so-called a photon, as we come to know them. On the right-hand side here, I've summarized some of the major steps that establishes different discoveries about the electron. You have, first of all, discovering the electron, and then Planck goes on to explain blackbody radiation, saying that these electrons only have certain energy levels, thus starting the quantized thing. We can get into that more later. And then Rutherford discovered the nucleus, ultimately leading to the Bohr model of the atom, and we're confirming that electrons can have specific energies level only once they're in an atom. So that's the electron side. The photon side, we have the photoelectric effect, which then Einstein combined with Planck's idea to explain, thus coming up with how electromagnetic radiation, their energy is also quantized, similar to how electric charge is quantized. You can't have less than one electron worth of charge. You can't have less than one of these steps worth of electromagnetic energy as well. And ultimately, Compton, through Compton scattering establishes that the light is actually a particle, and then eventually the term photon was coined. And from that, de Broglie, he came up with this idea of the matter waves, and ultimately Schrödinger and Dirac came up with a good framework upon which we build our understanding of quantum mechanics today. So despite everything I've said up to now, 1880s isn't exactly the dark ages of science. At this point, physicists know actually quite a few things. We have Newton's law of motion, we have Maxwell's electromagnetism, and we have thermodynamics, and statistical mechanics just coming online around this time. These all together do a very, very good job in explaining macroscopic phenomena. Things we can see, like motions of cars, lighting up a light bulb, and how things heat up, steam engines and such. All those are very well explained, and we still use them today as a testament of the fact that you've spent all these years learning about all this stuff. But this is about the turning point when we can start to look at more microscopic phenomena, and there the observations are really quite weird and can't be explained by these things, and thus starting the whole quote-unquote revolution. At this point, the view of matter and light are very separate. You have matter, which is made up of particles in the sense that they're atoms and molecules, because the electron hasn't been quite discovered yet, but they're countable in the sense that you can't have an infinitely small chunk of matter. At some point, you can't cut up matter anymore, and an atom is a basic unit of that. You can't have half an atom, say. Whereas light is thought of as an EM wave, electromagnetic wave, which we've dealt with earlier in the course. And this wave, because of the wave, it has a large spatial extent, unlike a particle, which is more or less localized. It can stretch out for a big vast of space, and that you can make the energy smaller and you have a smaller wave, and then you can make the energy smaller yet and you have a smaller wave, and so on and so forth. And the thought was you can make the wave as small as you want. Everything is nice and continuous. In 1900, that view suddenly get brought into question.